in this edition of Art Loft Girls Club.
So in the show, we've got photography, we've got painting, printmaking, bronze sculpture, ceramics, video installation, and even some drawing.
A curator's legacy.
When she ran out of space to show her art as she saw fit, she stopped collecting, which I find absolutely remarkable. So indeed, there were certain pieces that were not included, but really the vast majority of her collection is on view here today.
Melancholalaland.
I think it's a futuristic production about an evil corporation trying to use someone's beautiful work for themselves.
That's where the opera opens.
And Wild Inks at Misi Fi.
Today what I'm showcasing are some original works out of the God's Gates universe created by writer Philip Lee McCall II. This is our first comic project.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from the Art and Culture Center of Hollywood, this is Art Loft. Welcome to another edition of Art Loft. Coming up, a multimedia opera. We sample an art connoisseur's collection and more. But first, we head to Fort Lauderdale to visit Girls Club and to experience the moment, the backdrop, the persona. As we discuss this multiple media examination, we gain a deeper understanding of this program's mission.
Most of the work that's displayed here at the Girls Club is from our private collection. We decide about other works from a conversation that I would have with the curator, or the curator decides, or Michelle decides, or Sarah, and it would go with the show that we're going to have. So one of us would think this person's work would be very exciting. An artist might have an idea about another artist, so we're open. We don't have to follow rules.
The exhibition is called The Moment, The Backdrop, The Persona, and it looks at narrative art and story-based art from the collection of Francie Bishop Goode and David Horvitz. Narrative art is art that looks at the basic storytelling elements and incorporates that within their work. The exhibit doesn't create its own story. It actually has quite a few many stories or fragments of stories within it.
For me, the story's secondary. The first thing that attracts me would be the palette, the composition, and the concept. But the story, I don't know, it has to integrate somehow.
We have a lot of different mediums working as we see contemporary artists using every kind of media they can get their hands on to basically tell their own story through their work. So in the show, we've got photography, we've got painting, printmaking, bronze sculpture, ceramics, video installation, and even some drawing.
I don't consider photography and painting and sculpture different. I consider it all part of today's conversation in the arts. So it's hard to see something with a fresher attitude in any of these medias.
We do have quite a few video pieces in the show. Behind me, we see three of them, two by local artists, Jillian Mayer and Najid Shabaka, and one by Kate Gilmore. One piece in the show that might not be obvious as soon as you walk in, you have to sort of look for it, is a piece up on the higher edge of the wall by Jane Hammond. It's a painting on an abnormal shaped canvas of the head of Picasso. Some consider the father of modern art and contemporary art. And it's a head of him showing on a TV screen. and we thought that was a perfect addition to hover over the gallery here. It actually made some pretty unique relationships with other artworks, specifically the Chantal Joffe painting that's in the corner of the gallery. If you look at the right moment in the exhibition, you'll actually see Chantal's sitter and Picasso locking eyes, as if Kristen, who's the subject in Chantal's piece, is watching TV and watching the Picasso overlord figure of the show.
I want the visitors to come in and see a very highly personal collection, one that doesn't have like the greatest hits, and enjoy the work of all these fantastic artists. And it doesn't matter if they're a blue chip artist or if it's a homeless artist. You know, it's just art that I love, my point of view.
For more on Girls Club, visit girlsclubcollection.org.
Up next on Art Loft.
I think it's a futuristic production about an evil corporation trying to use someone's beautiful work for themselves.
That's where the opera opens.
From the Lowe Art Museum in Coral Gables, we're introduced to select works from the personal collection of renowned local arts enthusiast Francine Ruich. The Francine Ruich and the Ruich Family Collections features contemporary art in various media and is on display until September 27th. Take a look.
An overview, a general overview of this exhibition, which is The Collector's Legacy, the Francine C. Ruich and the Ruich Family Collections, is really a tribute to a woman who was a wonderful supporter of the Lowe Art Museum for many, many years, and she passed away about a year ago now. We really wanted to honor her contributions to the Lowe, but also to the wider arts community. We were thrilled to be able to put together this exhibition for her and her memory. Francine Ruich was quite fascinating because she had this very avant-garde taste. She was collecting artists who are now very successful, very well known as contemporary practitioners when they were still really just starting out. So she had this wonderful eye, a real eye for quality, but also this fearlessness about her. On the flip side, you can see the contemporary pieces behind me, but what you probably can't see is the other side of Fran and her collecting interests, which are 20th century vintage photographs from some of the biggest names that you would expect, Walker Evans, Helen Levitt, those sorts of individuals. So this is at least 2.5, 3 decades in the making. Fran was very special in that she wanted to live with her art. I mean, literally, she wanted to have it on her walls every single day and to have it be a part of her life and who she was. And that means that when she ran out of space to show her art as she saw fit, she stopped collecting, which I find absolutely remarkable. So indeed, there were certain pieces that were not included, but really the vast majority of her collection is on view here today. It's a wonderful spectrum, panorama of different types of art and the materials out of which they are made. And they sing together in this collection, which I think is the mark of a true collector, is that there doesn't have to be a theme, shall we say. Things can be very, if I say eclectic, I mean it in the nicest possible sense. There can be this eclecticism, but when they're put together, it's that passion, the collector's eye, that je ne sais quoi that he or she has that makes it all work. And that's where I think the magic lies in this exhibition.
This collection will be on display until September 27th. For more information, visit lowemuseum.org.
Up next on Art Loft.
Today what I'm showcasing are some original works out of the God's Gates universe created by writer Philip Lee McCall II. This is our first comic project.
Welcome back to Art Loft. Next, we visit a rehearsal for the multimedia opera Melancholalaland. Together, producers Joey Barkson and Thea Zimmer incorporate live vocalists, dancers, videos, and more into this imaginative production.
Oh, who's that? A windy fellow!
My name is Michelangelo Gonzalez. I'm 27 years old from Miami, Florida. And I'll be doing the role of Robert Burton, Charlie, and Person One at the end of the opera.
I'm Joey Bargston. I'm the composer of the opera Melancholalaland. I also do the direction, the videography, some of the animation, and a number of other aspects of the production.
I think it's a futuristic production about an evil corporation trying to use someone's beautiful work for themselves.
That's where the opera opens, in this kind of corporate, dysfunctional corporate world. And it expands into a number of other settings. It expands into the mind of the main character, Booster. It shows him relating to his brain chemicals as expressed in dance. The scene that we're going to be rehearsing is called Booster's Suicide Attempt. And Booster, the main character, is spiraling down into depression. His girlfriend just left him. His position in the company has been replaced, in fact, by his girlfriend. For this particular production, we are stressing live vocalists. We have three live vocalists who will be performing in front of and interacting with video characters. We have dance elements, contemporary dance elements, that will be also presented as video components. Also, dancers and other characters that are presented in the video world. So there are animation elements, video elements, and live performance of traditionally sung operatic voices.
Well, talk singing is called recit, or recitative, which is basically just sung speech where you get a script, you put some notes to it, and the elongated notes is what the singing comes through. And that's what Wretched is. I think that Joey Bargston, the composer, did a wonderful job, because with every note descending, ascending, held, it really fleshes out the character. For example, Robert Burton, a lot of the notes are low, almost muted, and when he gets into this emotional height, they go higher and stronger, which is really an indication of who he is as a person. Working with Joey Bargston and Thea Zimmer has been a joy. They're very open-minded. They say, we come in with your ideas, you come in with yours, and we really make it like a joint effort, which has made this the opera of a lifetime.
What I would like audiences to take away from this production is just a sense of possibility. And hopefully they will start kind of connecting the dots between opera and contemporary music and electronic music and dance and theater and animation and video and interactivity.
The next performance will be at Miami Beach Cinematheque on Sunday, September 13, 2015. For more info, visit melancholalaland.wordpress.com.
Up next on Art Loft.
If I'm going to do a three-dimensional object, then I have to think about the whole piece and all around it.
Up next, we return to the Miami International Science Fiction Film Festival to check in with Wild Inc.'s illustrator, Kenny Calderon. During the festival, Calderon gave us a peek at the art behind author Philip Lee McCall II's Grace Flynn novel.
My name is Kenny Calderon. I'm an illustrator, comic book artist based out of South Florida. Today what I'm showcasing are some original works out of the God's Gates universe created by writer Philip Lee McCall II. This is our first comic project. He's normally a novelist of sorts. So This is the first time his work has been put into the comic medium. The first book is based on a character called Grace Flynn. She's a female pirate set in the 1800s during the golden age of piracy. And the story is excellent. It's reminiscent of, like, say, 300, where it's set in an actual historical time period with a lot of fantasy elements. So in the tale, you'll come across things like the Sword of Excalibur, werewolves and vampires, along with, you know, some pretty eccentric and embellished pirate characters. Grace Flynn, in the best way that I can describe her, is she is probably the best and strongest female character next to Wonder Woman. In her universe, she is the most dangerous woman alive. The Grace Flynn mythos not only touches the fantasy aspect of storytelling, but it also goes into steampunk and a lot of the industrial stuff and alchemy and so forth, you know, which is popular among the sci-fi groups. The Grace Flynn book is available on Amazon. I am on all social media, Wildings Productions, spelled with a Z, on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
For more on this novel, visit plmii.com. And for more about Wild Inks, visit wildinks.com. Next week on Art Loft.
This is an exhibition that came out of the research trip that I did about 2 years ago in Winnipeg, Canada. I was invited by a small yet very vibrant art organization based in Winnipeg called MAWA.
A step inside Kathy Barnard's studio is like finding a key to a secret garden. A garden where flocks of gossamer sparrows soar across transparent skies, and lush galaxies of vines and morning glories sprawl with vivid dimension across quarter-inch glass. But this garden almost looked very different. While working at Hallmark, Kathy learned to sandblast and soon set her sights on creating custom signage. But that was until a trip to California altered her course forever.
I went to LA. And I went on a tour of the Queen Mary, the luxury ocean liner. And they had carved glass, and it was edge lit, and it was bas relief, and I loved it. I'd always loved Steuben and Lalique glass, but I didn't know how to do it. But I thought, if I know how to carve in wood, I probably could figure out how to carve in glass. So I just started experimenting.
And having never been formally taught the parameters of her newfound craft, she was able to nimbly push the limits of the medium and soon found a strong following.
Knew more people like through Hyde Park and people who were restoring their homes, and I started doing work for some of the homes there. Got so busy that I asked for a leave of absence from Hallmark, and I never went back. That was over 30 years ago. I did for a while just do the smaller pieces, the bowls, vases, and my work was in galleries all over the United States and a few in Europe. I did that straight for 3 years. It was wonderful. I had so many orders, but what I missed was I didn't meet the people I was doing the work for. I didn't get to see the joy on their faces when we reach an idea that we both love, or they see the piece for the first time.
So she set out to reclaim that spark that was missing by working directly with clients on site-specific pieces. And the breadth of the work that followed was nothing short of astounding. Like this bank in Oklahoma that over the course of 2.5 years was transformed into this exquisite nature scene. Like this sublime private chapel in Clinton, Missouri. Or even closer to home, in the dazzling facade of the Midland Theater. And every design, no matter how great or small, starts with Kathy's first love, drawing, and then progresses through several meticulous stages of rendering before it's ready to be sandblasted.
My first task is to have wonderful research in front of me. The more I know about my subject, the better I'm going to illustrate it. So what I do first is I'll do sketches. I grew up at 75th and Neiman, and there was a creek nearby. And so my Saturdays would be to go down to the creek, and I would spend all day there. And the longer you sit, you start to recognize that a certain bird has a certain way of moving through the trees. I'm fascinated by it all. And I'll do many, many drawings like this. If I'm going to do several butterflies, I will try and get to know each butterfly and the characteristics. And I think this kind of helps me get life into the subject. And with that as inspiration, if I'm going to do a three-dimensional object, then I have to think about the whole piece and all around it. So I've developed a way of doing that. I start to draw right on the piece. I might establish where my pathway of butterflies are going to fly. That doesn't mean I have to draw it perfectly on this. What I'm trying to do is establish the flow. I can then start to translate my design. Now I'll put another piece of tracing paper down and do very detailed drawings. The more detailed I can do my initial drawing, the more I know what to do when I get in to sandblast it.
The piece is then carefully masked to protect the glass from unwanted abrasion. And finally, after hours of designing, transposing, and masking, the composition is painstakingly carved into the tape. Kathy then dons her safety gear and prepares to sandblast.
Waking up every day. I'm very blessed to be able to come in here into my studio and do what I love to do. I love to draw. I love to create things. I love the joy of people receiving and viewing what I've created. And I guess that keeps me going every day. I just love it. I love life.
Thanks so much for joining us this week. Let Art Loft inspire creativity every day. Visit WPBT2.org/ArtLoft to watch past episodes and get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kaylin James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye. No, she was not. Mike's like, whatever. Shut up. Unbreakable. Still alive. Dead. My throat feels like it's trying to start hurting. Check. Hey. I don't know how to stand without my heels. This feels weird. Did a rehearsal for the multimedia opera, Melon. Wait, how long? Hold on. Wait a minute. What? Understanding of the mission. Flexion, yes. Do your flexion, boo. Display until September 27th. Take a look. I liked it. I liked it a lot. In fact, I loved it. It was amazing. Museum.org. Whoops.
I need oil on my ankles. All right, good. You like it, I love it. What? And I was like, it's a crab. She was, total meltdown. Watch it.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.